गुजारिश करूंगा डॉक्टर नरेंद्र जाधव जी, ग्रेट इकोनॉमिस्ट, ऑनरेबल मेंबर ऑफ पार्लियामेंट, राज्यसभा।
जय भीम टू एवरीबॉडी। संविधान दिवस की आप सबको बहुत बहुत बधाई। देखिए, मैं भाषण की शुरुआत करता हूं। मैं अंग्रेजी में बोलने वाला हूं। अभी तक सारे लोग हिंदी में बोले हैं, मैं अंग्रेजी में बोलने वाला हूं। वेल फ्रेंड्स, आई फील ग्रेटली ऑनर्ड टू हैव बीन इनवाइटेड टू स्पीक इन दिस ऑगस्ट फोरम। एट द आउटसेट, लेट मी कमेंड द फोरम ऑफ शेड्यूल्ड कास्ट एंड शेड्यूल्ड ट्राइब लेजिस्लेटर्स एंड पार्लियामेंटेरियंस, स्पेशली इट्स वर्किंग प्रेसिडेंट श्री इंदर इकबाल सिंह अटवाल फॉर ऑर्गेनाइजिंग दिस 2-डे इंटरनेशनल अम्बेडकर कॉन्क्लेव ऑन सब्जेक्ट्स ऑफ ग्रेट कंटेम्पररी रिलेवेंस। एज मेनी ऑफ यू आर अवेयर, सो फार आई हैव रिटन 21 बुक्स ऑन डॉक्टर बाबा साहेब अम्बेडकर इन 3 लैंग्वेजेस, इन इंग्लिश, इन हिंदी एंड इन मराठी। व्हाट आई प्रपोज टू डू इन नेक्स्ट 15 मिनट्स इज टू गिव यू ए ब्रॉड ओवरव्यू ऑफ द जीनियस ऑफ डॉक्टर बाबा साहेब अम्बेडकर एज एन इंटेलेक्चुअल कलोसस एज वेल एज अ ग्रेट नेशनल लीडर। भारत रत्न डॉक्टर बाबा साहेब अम्बेडकर, अफेक्शनेटली नोन एज बाबा साहेब अम्बेडकर, वॉज अनडाउटेडली वन ऑफ द मोस्ट इलस्ट्रियस सन्स ऑफ इंडिया। He appeared on the Indian socio-political scene in the early 1920s and remained at the forefront of social, cultural, economic and political transformation of India in the closing decades of the British rule. And after India became independent from the British rule in 1947, Dr. Baba Saheb Ambedkar played a uniquely significant role in laying down the foundation of modern India till his Mahaparinirvan in 1956. Dr. Ambedkar was a great social reformer, a valiant champion of human rights, and an emancipator of the downtrodden masses of India. Dr. Ambedkar was truly an intellectual colossus and a great national leader who dedicated his life to bringing in a new dawn of enlightenment in our country, in the modern India. Dr. Ambedkar's life is an incredible saga. An untouchable boy, humiliated every step of the way from the childhood to the youth, beats all odds securing the highest and the most reputable degrees from the world-class universities. Masters, that is MA and PhD, both in economics from Columbia University, United States, in the year 1915 and 1917. And then he went to London School of Economics, from where he got his Doctor of Science degree. And while in London, he also got his barrister's degree. He then returned to India and devoted his life to the destruction of the caste-ridden old order, which was characterized by injustice and denial of human rights. Without being favored either by family fortune or by family political lineage, but by sheer grit of his determination and back-breaking hard work, supreme courage and selfless sacrifice, Dr. Ambedkar overcame bitter political opposition and perils of caste discrimination to become the principal architect of the Constitution of Independent India. He then proceeded to build the safeguards of affirmative action for establishing a more equitable society that is capable of delivering social justice to millions of people, heralding in India a new age of social equality and rationalism. And in this process, friends, Dr. Ambedkar came out to the forefront not only as a valiant champion of Indian Republic, but he also emerged as a conscious keeper of modern India. No wonder there there are more statues of Dr. Ambedkar in India than any other leader of our nation. It is also hardly surprising that every year on December 6th, which is the death anniversary of Dr. Ambedkar, around 2 million Ambedkarites throng to Chaitya Bhumi in Mumbai to pay homage to the hero whom they worship as their savior. It is also not surprising that Dr. Ambedkar was voted in August 2012 as the greatest Indian after Gandhi with an overwhelming majority of votes in an e-poll initiated by some TV channels. Many Indians, mind you, many Indians, especially in the middle class and the elite, found the results of the e-poll rather surprising. There were five top contenders: Dr. Ambedkar, Dr. Abdul Kalam, Vallabhbhai Patel, Jawaharlal Nehru and Mother Teresa, in that order. In fact, in the popular vote segment, Dr. Ambedkar polled more votes than the sum total of all the votes of the four other contenders. As a matter of, and this is not surprising at all, what is surprising is the fact that Dr. Ambedkar was elected as the greatest Indian after Gandhi in spite of being largely kept away from the mainstream India and even in the Indian education system. Traditionally, the textbooks in India are replete with stories of the life and times of Mahatma Gandhi and Jawaharlal Nehru. Pedagogy portrays, and rightly so, Gandhiji and Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru as the leaders of national stature in the prose and poem, skit and song. Regrettably, however, Dr. Ambedkar appears only briefly, if at all. And when he does appear, invariably he is referred to as the leader of untouchables. Dr. Ambedkar's representation in pedagogy has always been marginal or parenthetical, as a caste leader and not as a national leader. Dr. Ambedkar, it is grossly unfair to characterize Dr. Ambedkar simply as a leader of untouchables or Dalits. In fact, to my mind, to give you the essence of his personality, there are 12 different facets of this multifaceted genius that we need to at least know briefly about. 12 different facets of his personality. First one is knowledge seeker par excellence. Second, economist extraordinaire. In fact, the greatest economist that India produced was not Amartya Sen. The greatest economist that India produced was Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. The third aspect is a social reformer and emancipator of the downtrodden. Fourth aspect is he was an outstanding economic administrator. As a minister in the British government between 1942 to 1946, the kind of reforms that he brought about were most remarkable. So he proved himself not only as a bookish economist, but as a great economic administrator. He was an educationist with social conscience. A lot of that has been talked about this morning. He was a champion of annihilation of caste. He was an anthropologist with a great difference. He was the first law minister of independent India who tried to promote the Hindu court bill. He was an epoch-making statesman. He was the principal architect of the Indian constitution. He was a critique of linguistic reorganization of states. And ultimately, he was the modern-day champion of Buddhism. These are the 12 different facets to his personality, and all of them are pan-India. They are all Indian. They are not confined to Dalits alone. It is therefore grossly unfair to characterize Dr. Ambedkar simply as a leader of untouchables. Dr. Ambedkar was not simply a leader of untouchables, not even only a leader of the oppressed people of India. He was a national leader, period. Dr. Ambedkar's erudition, his mass movements, his role in the government in heralding what we now call inclusive growth, his role in emphasizing gender equality. He was the only person, only minister who actually resigned when he could not get the Hindu court bill through. So in the interest of gender equality, he is the only minister in our history who actually resigned from his cabinet minister position. He emphasized education for all. He was the first one. You know, these are things which are not known. Who started? There's so much talk about skill development. Who started the skill development in the official sector in India? You'll be surprised. Skill development for the first time was started in India as a minister in the British government by Dr. Ambedkar in 1943. But we are blissfully unaware of that. His role as a labor welfare, labor minister, you know, many of the reforms that we see, labor welfare measures, including maternity leave, reducing the number of hours, all these things were done by Dr. Ambedkar when he was a minister in the British cabinet. We do not know that. It was Dr. Ambedkar, of all the persons, it was Dr. Ambedkar who said that we all must be Indian first, Indian last, and nothing else in between. So he placed the nationhood at the top of his priorities. In the course of his most eventful life, Dr. Ambedkar made an outstanding contribution to so many fields as an economist, as a sociologist, as an anthropologist, as an educationist, as a journalist, as an authority on comparative religion, as a policymaker, as an administrator, and as a parliamentarian, besides being a jurist who became the principal architect of the Indian Constitution. In spite of being a statesman and a mass leader, Dr. Ambedkar was always, he always remained a reflective thinker and an erudite scholar. Even while being fully engrossed in mass movement and political upheavals, Dr. Ambedkar wrote remarkable treatises in economics, in sociology, in anthropology, politics, law, religion, and culture, which is a mark of a true intellectual. Dr. Ambedkar was a prolific writer. Perhaps no other mass leader in India, show me another mass leader in India who has produced anywhere even close to the voluminous writings that Dr. Ambedkar did. The sheer volume is astounding. 22 books and monographs completed and published, plus 10 books which were left behind incomplete at various stages, 10 major memoranda and statements submitted to various authorities, 10 research papers, articles, book reviews, besides hundreds of articles in Marathi in his various fortnightly journals. The analytical rigor, lucidity, insights, and passion that exude Dr. Ambedkar's writings is truly phenomenal. The range of Dr. Ambedkar's works is also equally amazing. On politics, he wrote 11 books and monographs, including treatises such as Pakistan or Partition of India, What Congress and Gandhi Have Done to Untouchables in 1945, the classics such as Federation versus Freedom, Ranade Gandhi and Jinnah in 1943, States and Minorities in 1947, and Thoughts on Linguistic States in 1955. On economics, he wrote two path-breaking books. One was based on his PhD dissertation, and other one based on his Doctor of Science dissertation. His PhD dissertation was called The Evolution of Provincial Finances in British India. In that book, which was published in 1925, but it was based on his dissertation completed in 1917. That book, you will be surprised that was a seminal book, which is the basis of the center-state financial relations even today. In our country, every 5 years a finance commission is appointed. 15th finance commission is about to be appointed. If you look at all the 14 finance commission's reports so far, the basic seminal source of all of them is nothing but the book that was written by Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar on the evolution of provincial finances in British India. Then there is another book that he wrote on economics, The Problem of Rupee, Its Origin and Its Solution. This is a classic book on monetary economics, which is a very complicated book. This is the book which was based on his PhD dissertation. And you will be surprised, it was mentioned in the morning that Dr. Ambedkar played some role in the formation of the Reserve Bank of India. In 1926, Hilton Young Commission had come to India to establish a central bank for the country, that is the Reserve Bank of India. And Dr. Ambedkar's testimony before that was very, very important and critical. Yet, you will be surprised that if you look at the official history of Reserve Bank of India, you will find no mention of Dr. Ambedkar and his seminal contribution in terms of the testimony before the Hilton Young Commission. Dr. Ambedkar wrote several books on sociology. His timeless contribution is The Annihilation of Caste. Besides his remarkable essay on caste in India, their genesis, mechanism and development. On anthropology, he wrote two provocatively original treatises. One was Who Were Shudras in 1946 and The Untouchables, Who Were They and Why They Became Untouchables in 1948. And finally, on the subject of religion, Dr. Ambedkar wrote his magnum opus, Buddha and Dhamma. What is simply astounding, not only amazing, but astounding, is that Dr. Ambedkar produced all these magnificent books while being fully engaged in the political movement and being fully engaged in drafting the Constitution of India. That was the genius of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. With Dr. Ambedkar's intellectual stature and monumental contribution, making equality and social justice the cornerstone of the world's most populous democracy that India is, one would have expected an exalted position, a distinctive place carved out for Dr. Ambedkar in the Indian pantheon, along with Mahatma Gandhi, Pandit Nehru, and all others. Why has this not happened until recently? Why has Dr. Ambedkar been traditionally marginalized and diminished in stature? Why has he been relegated until recently only as a Dalit leader and at the best as the principal architect of the Indian Constitution, and that too rather reluctantly? Why was Dr. Ambedkar given Bharat Ratna Award 34 years after his death? There are several possible explanations which need not detain us here and now. What is more important is to note that there is a growing nationwide recognition of Dr. Ambedkar across the entire spectrum of political parties, which is most welcome. A more pertinent question that should be asked is, why is this happening now? Is Dr. Ambedkar being rediscovered posthumously, being resurrected, and is being born again? Not quite. Dr. Ambedkar has always been He has always had an everyday presence in the lives of more than 200 million strong Dalit communities throughout this country. His ideas and legacy have consistently been inspiring the disadvantaged and the downtrodden in our country. On December 6th, which marks Dr. Ambedkar's death anniversary, huge crowds, as I mentioned, thronged to Chaityabhoomi, Mumbai, to pay homage to his memory. Over the years, the numbers have been swelling, now reaching up to 2 million people every year. Large crowds also assemble on October 14th every year at Nagpur to observe the anniversary of Dr. Ambedkar's conversion to Buddhism. In fact, it is this large and growing following of Dr. Ambedkar that seems to have inspired the political parties across the country to take note of Dr. Ambedkar as a political expediency. Nevertheless, it is heartening to see the widespread renewed interest in Dr. Ambedkar. Evidently, the Indian society has done itself an irreparable and enormous damage by not recognizing the national contribution of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. Correcting the misguided impression confining Dr. Ambedkar only as a leader of Dalits, understanding him in his true nationalist spirit and placing him in the galaxy of the great national leaders of our country is indeed a need of the hour. And this is precisely why this International Ambedkar Conclave, organized by the Forum of Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribe Legislators and Parliamentarians, is most timely with a great contemporary relevance. Thank you. Thank you very much. मच।